ولا يوجد طلب واحد يرد من آدم إلى قيام الساعة. فقال: وإذا سألك عبادي عني فإني قريب أجيب. ترى أنا قريب وأعطيك. قد تطلب من ملك من ملوك الدنيا شيء فيعطيك، لكنه ما هو قريب منك. عندي وايد، عم تبي سيارة خذ سيارة، قد يعطيك لكنه ما هو قريب، قد ما يعزك صح بس يعطيك. لا يوجد طلب واحد من العباد يرفع إلا ويعطى.
If you feel yourself suffocating, if you feel the constriction of the chest, if you feel like you can't move, you can't operate due to the global circumstances or due to the circumstances in your own home, وَمَنْ أَعْرَضَ عَنْ ذِكْرِي فَإِنَّ لَهُ مَعِيشَةً ضَنْكَ. When you turn away from the remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, things become constricted, tight. But dhikr opens the pathways. Remembering Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the midst of madness is the only way that a person can survive. And remembering Allah does not simply mean repetition on the tongue. Remembering who Allah is as you remember Him with your tongue. And thinking deeply about what you're saying when you remember Him with your tongue. And then allowing that to penetrate your heart when you remember Him with your tongue. That opens the pathways. It allows you to breathe, to not suffocate when things are happening.
You know, on the Day of Judgment, Allah Azza wa Jal, Allah Azza wa Jal, imagine this is the Day of Judgment. This is a day that is 50,000 years long. It is a day when Allah Azza wa Jal will bring onto one plane every single angel, every single prophet, every single human being, every jinn, every animal, everything that Allah Jalla Jalalu has ever created will come forward on this day. And then on the Day of Judgment, Allah Azza wa Jal, He will call for Jahannam to be brought forward. Jahannam, the actual hellfire, this creation of Allah Azza wa Jal, it will be brought forward to humanity. In the authentic hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, he says that Jahannam will be brought forward and it'll be dragged. 70,000 brindles, chains, 70,000 chains that are attached to Jahannam, and it will be dragged forward. He says 70,000 brindles, chains, and on every chain there are 70,000 angels. 4.9 billion angels will be dragging Jahannam forward. And then Allah Azza wa Jal says in the Quran that when Jahannam, when this creation that was created for no purpose other than to punish humanity, that's it. The only job of Jahannam was to punish the human being. So Allah Azza wa Jal says that on the Day of Judgment, when Jahannam sees the human being for the first time, it's been created for Allahu A'lam how many thousands of years, it's been burning for Allahu A'lam how long, and it's been waiting for this day. So when Jahannam sees the human being for the first time, Allah Azza wa Jal says it will release like an expression, it's like it'll burst. It's like it'll burst out of anger. And then Allah mentions in the Quran that when Jahannam bursts and the human being sees this with his own eyes, Allah Azza wa Jal says at that moment, every single living thing will fall to its knees in prostration to Allah. The good, the bad, the ugly, the Muslim, the non-Muslim, the one who believed, the one who didn't believe, the one who wanted to see, the one who didn't want to see. When they see this with their eyes, they will fall in prostration. But on that day, Allah will say, stand up. Today is not the day of worship. Today is the day of judgment. You believing then is of no value. Believing after you see is of no weight. Your iman then will weigh nothing in the sight of Allah.
I was in Mecca a few days ago and I saw as I was walking, it was very busy. It was almost like Hajj. You know, before there was a time when you had seasons for Umrah, Ramadan and so on. But now, because it's so easy to travel, it's full. The Mataf is full almost all the time. So I felt something under my feet. When I looked, I saw a head covering, a scarf, a long scarf of a woman. And I kicked it and I realized that it's got knots on it. And my son who was with me told me, someone's done magic. By that time, we had already moved past. And I'm a person, because I know about ruqya and I know about what to do, how to do it. I said, inshallah, if we go around and we see the same thing, I'm going to take it out and I'm going to undo these knots. I know that that won't work in the haram in Mecca. It won't work. So whoever did whatever they did, what they did is they took someone's headscarf, probably with their sweat and whatever else that might have been, and they tied knots. They must have blown in it. There's ways of doing magic, which unfortunately is becoming very common. The hadith says, whoever does it has distanced from Allah, associated partners with Allah. Whoever believes it or goes to someone who does it has disbelieved in what Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam has brought. So you basically come out of Islam the minute you involve in that, even through a third party. For as long as it was you who tried to do some magic on someone, you no longer can call yourself a follower of Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That's how bad it is. So we came round and lo and behold, I saw it. I picked it up and I started reading the same surah Sheikh Adnan was speaking about, and I'm opening this to a stench, a smell that I couldn't even imagine. Right outside the Kaaba in our tawaf. And I'm opening one after the other. And in my mind I said, you know what? This is Allah. I don't think people would have the guts and courage to go up and to undo. And I'm thinking to myself, 11 knots, that was the type of magic done on the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. 11 knots that someone had tied, inshallah, it wouldn't have affected someone, but I actually undid it, even if it did affect someone. I don't know who it was. And I told myself, it's shocking how people can come to Mecca and do this. It's disbelief. It removes you from Islam. You cannot do magic on someone. It does exist. It's there, but it's prohibited. It's not allowed. It's a test from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You don't like someone, you're not allowed to do something to them that's actually detrimental to your own connection with Allah. Sometimes you love someone and you want to bring them closer to you, so you end up going to a guy or anyone who's going to tell you, okay, I can do some deed that can bring his heart under control. What on earth do you think you're doing? You're losing faith totally. You literally are no longer a Muslim. Literally no longer a Muslim. You're not allowed to do that. The hadith says, Man ata arrafan aw kahinan. Oh, in fact, the one hadith says, Man sahara faqad ashrak. Whoever does magic has associated partners with Allah. They've done shirk. Straight, that's a hadith. So you cannot do the magic. Another one says, whoever goes to a fortune teller, a soothsayer, any of these people, and believes what they're doing or what they've said about the future and about things of the unseen, they have disbelieved in what the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam brought. What did he bring? Islam. So it does exist.
بس شنو الأحلى؟ هل ذكر مثلا شنو أحلى شيء في الجنة؟ أحلى شيء.
لا شك. إن أعظم نعيم في الجنة تلك اللحظات في يوم الجمعة التي يحضر أهل الجنة جميعا في مكان واحد في الوادي الأفيح، وهذا المكان يجهز لهم في منابر من نور ومنابر من ذهب ومنابر من ياقوت ومنابر من فضة، ثم يجلس الأنبياء والرسل، ثم يأتي أهل الجنة جميعا لأعظم هدية وأعظم إنجاز وأعظم مفاجأة من الله عز وجل، وهي أن يروا الله عز وجل. وجوه يومئذ ناظرة إلى ربها ناظرة، يرون الله عز وجل كما نرى نحن القمر ليلة البدر. وشوف شوف المشهد أنت، الله عز وجل حوله الأنبياء والرسل، قدامه أكيد الصحابة، وإحنا كذلك جالسين ننتظر هذه الرؤية. فيكشف الجبار جل جلاله عن وجهه الحجاب، فلا يرى أهل الجنة نعيما كهذا النعيم. الله يجعلنا وياك
آمين.
ممن ينظرون تلك النظرة إلى الله عز وجل. في جنات النعيم.
ومن أعرض عن ذكري فإن له معيشة ضنكا ونحشره يوم